here is short-run total cost function, the one that you've been learning about during your introduction to microeconomics class. Look, let's just review what you've learned over there. Okay, so first of all, here we have the function. This is total cost function. Total cost, of course, is made of variable cost and fixed cost. Fixed cost is the cost that company endures even if the company is not producing. So when total cost function, when level of production is zero, company still needs to cover the fixed cost. So like cost of renting a factory. Okay, and then what happens? Due to the law of diminishing returns, we know that at the beginning, cost is increasing less than proportionally, and then it increases more than proportionally. So, look, now we can show exactly the same in terms of marginal cost. We see that the bigger is the level of production, the bigger the cost, which means that marginal cost must be positive. But, and so as we see over here, marginal cost is always above zero. But look, if the function here is increasing less than proportionally, it means it's concave. So it means that the first derivative of this function has a negative slope, as you can see over here. And at this point, the function is actually increasing more than proportionally, which means that marginal cost must have positive slope. And of course, we see that this point corresponding to inflection point for the short run, corresponding to the short run total cost function, is the minimum of the marginal cost. Now, what is marginal cost? Of course, this is a cost of producing one additional unit. But look, in strictly mathematic terms, we can write it as a first derivative of total cost with respect to quantity, the level of production. Now, another category that interests us is that average cost is average cost, and this is the cost of production, the cost of production per one unit. Okay, and you also learned during microeconomics class that average cost takes the lowest value, so has the minimum, at the point where it intercepts with marginal cost. What we are going to do now is that we are going to prove it. Now, how we are going to do it? Look, we just simply need to look for minimum of average cost. So, we need to find the derivative of average cost and compare it with zero, right? But look, if we are finding the derivative of average cost, what we are actually differentiating is expression C over Q, so total cost over quantity. Now look, this is a quotient, so what is appropriate is to use the quotient rule. Now, how do we go about it? Well, we will have, of course, in the denominator, we take the denominator from this expression and we put it into the second power and we take it to the second power. Then, derivative of this expression times second expression minus first expression times derivative of the second expression. But look, derivative of Q with respect to Q is like the derivative of X with respect to X. So just one. Okay, and look, this needs to be equal to zero. But look, right away, we are not considering zero value of quantity. We assume that some production, some level of production is considered. And of course, production must be positive, it's in square. So definitely, this expression cannot be equal to zero. So look, what we need to consider is only the numerator over here. And what do we have in the numerator? Derivative of total cost is simply marginal cost times quantity equals total cost minus total cost equals to zero. Now, let's move total cost over here. And divide both sides of the equation by Q. What do we get? Minimum of the average cost function is at a place where marginal cost is exactly equal to average cost, which is the same conclusion that you learned about in your microeconomics class. Okay, but look, let's get a little bit deeper into it. The short run total cost function has a very specific shape, but right away we can notice that we saw this shape somewhere. And this shape is associated with cubic function. So now we can use cubic function to model a short run total cost. Okay, so but what we need to do now is to make sure that this cubic function that we're gonna use will actually fulfill everything that we said over here. It cannot be decreasing, which is a possibility, and so we need to have the function that is increasing, the function that has non-zero fixed cost, and besides that, this is it. This is all we actually need. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna find coefficients of cubic total cost function. Okay, so our cubic total cost function will look like this. This is a function, of course, of level of production, and it's given by A cube plus B cube square plus C cube plus D. Okay, and now let's talk about all the requirements that we discussed a second ago. So first, fixed cost must be positive. But look, what is fixed cost? Fixed cost for any total cost function is the cost we've got when level of production is equal to zero. In our case, if I'm gonna take and substitute zero instead of Q, this expression's gone. We've got D. So D is actually the fixed cost. So first restriction we need to impose is that D must be positive. Okay, so let's go further. Secondly, we need to be sure that this function is always how make sure of that? Well, the first derivative, marginal cost, should be always positive. How do we do it? Okay, first, let's find marginal cost in this case. So, we've got that, we've got the from the derivative 3aq squared plus 2bq plus c. Okay, right away, we see that this is quadratic function. Now, quadratic function will have U shape or a shape of a valley if coefficient up front is positive. And it will have inverted U shape or shape of a hill if this coefficient is negative. So look, in this case, if the coefficient would be negative, those two would go over here. We could have negative marginal cost. This is prohibited. So this coefficient needs to be positive, which means that A must clearly be positive. Okay, so what should we do next? Look, the function can still be, so we can be sure that this parabola that we've got needs to have hands up. But there is still possibility that minimum of this parabola can be below zero, which is again prohibited. What can we do to avoid it? We need to make sure that the minimum value is above zero. So let's find minimum. So we differentiate marginal cost with respect to quantity. We get that this is 6a q plus 2b. This must be equal to zero. And we get that 6a q equals to negative b, 2b. So consequently, q must be equal to negative, let's already cancel the 2b over 3a. Okay, so look, now we know that this is the minimum of the marginal, I'm sorry, this is of, yes, of marginal cost. Second derivative is 6a, right? So it's positive. We are sure that this is a minimum. But now, look, we also need to make sure that quantity is positive. Because a is positive, and we have minus over here, for this expression to be positive, we need to be sure that b is negative. And this is how we obtain yet another restriction. Okay, but this is not it. We, for now, assured that quantity is positive, but we have not assured that marginal cost is positive. So, now we just need to take the outcome we've got and we need to substitute it into the marginal cost function. So, marginal cost at minimum is equal to 3a times minus b over 3a squared plus 2b times minus b over 3a plus c. Okay, so look, if I'm going to take this to the power of 2, I'm going to get b squared over 9a squared. But if I divide it by 3a, I'm going to get just 3a. Look, over here, I'm going to get negative 2b squared over 3a. Now, we see that those two are in the, have common denominators, so maybe it's a good idea to take c to the common denominator, and we then need to just change c to 3ac over 3a, right? Now, if we calculate it all out, we get that this is 3ac minus b squared over 3a. And we need to make sure that this expression is positive. Because we already established that A needs to be positive, this needs to be positive. And because this needs to be positive, it means that our next condition is that 3AC minus B squared is positive, or simply 3AC is bigger than B squared. But look again, what does this imply? For if A is positive, B squared must be positive. In order for the for this expression to be bigger than this one, this expression needs to be positive. And this happens only if C is bigger than zero. Okay, so concluding, we can demonstrate, we've demonstrated that the cubic function, that the cubic cost function A to the power A cube, cube plus B cube square plus C cube plus D is a proper model of a short-run cost function if A, C, and D are all positive, and B is negative, and 3AC is bigger than B squared. Assuming those conditions are fulfilled, we can be sure that this cubic cost function is a good model of a short-run cost. So, now let's make an example. Let's use the same total cost function we have used in the previous video in our exercise on finding maximum profit, and let's see if this function actually can be used as a proper total cost function. So we've got C equals 1 over 3 q to the power of 3 minus 7 q squared plus 11 q plus 15. Okay, so let's go through all the conditions step by step. A, 1 over 3. The way it should be. B is equal to negative 7. It's negative the way it should be. C is equal to 111. Positive the way it should be. And D is equal to 50. Again, positive the way it should be. So the only condition that remains to check for us is whether 3AC is bigger than B squared. In our case, we've got that this is 3 times 1 over 3 times 111 must be bigger than 7 squared. I'm sorry, negative 7 squared. This is simply 111. This is 49. And 111 is clearly bigger than 49. So, in this particular case, we see the function we've used in the previous exercise describes the total cost function very well. Okay, thank you for your attention. See you in the next video.